Colin Cowherd.
The Herd.
On ESPN Radio and ESPNRadio.com.
Now Ori out front, 10 seconds, Kobe Bryant against Christie. Kobe Bryant on the move against Christie, in for the right, flips his shot up, no good. O'Neal lays it up, missed it. Ball tipped out to Ori, a straight on three. Good! The Lakers have won! Robert Ori's greatest hits tour continues.
Oh, no doubt about it. He's got to be getting a Grammy for that one.
Seven-time NBA champion, played 16 years in the NBA, and never failed to make the playoffs.
Exactly.
16 for 16, never eliminated in the first round. One of the really good guys, Robert Ori, wearing his Alabama football shirt, asked me during the break, so what are you going to do now that USC is going into the tank? It's interesting. It looks like, to me, the Lakers look like the most talented team. That doesn't always win championships. They've struggled against elite teams. Are they struggling against the good teams because of injuries or because they're just waiting for the playoffs? Or are they overrated?
They're not overrated. They're the best team in the NBA right now. And I think it's a period of time where you have those little lulls. And you got to realize you went all the way to the end of the season. Sometimes your body gets tired. And I know that from a fact from winning seven championships. You go out there and you think you have that energy, and all of a sudden the second, third quarter, he was like, where did my energy go? I think they hit periods where they body the red down, and they need that extra adrenaline that comes from the playoffs to push them through that, and they don't have it right now.
Yeah, but my gut feeling is they will have it.
They will have it.
There's generally not a lot of upsets in the NBA playoffs. Over seven games, best team wins. Is there a dark horse in the NBA playoffs, East or West, this year?
I'm a big fan of the Denver Nuggets. I think, you know, Carmelo Anthony, from what he's done, is probably one of the MVPs of the game. You know, I know everybody's pushing LeBron and Kobe, but to me, Carmelo has been the MVP. He's doing a lot of more things. He's going out getting his team points, getting his team rebounds. You know, LeBron does all that, but LeBron has more to work with than Carmelo does.
It is interesting. I got into this discussion the other day with Bill Simmons, and I said if there was 10 seconds and I got the ball, who would take the last shot in the league? And I said Kobe, Carmelo, and LeBron. And people were like, you're crazy, LeBron. But I love LeBron the player, but if you one shot – to win the championship in the NBA, who's your top three?
Kobe, Chauncey Billups, and D-Wade.
What?
Yes.
Chauncey Billups?
Hey, you know, he tried to take my name, Mr. Big Shot, so I'm going to give it to him. And Chauncey's good. Except for the other night when he took that game winner against Cleveland, I was like, no, give it to Carmelo because he was hot. But, you know, I like Chauncey.
All right. But you like LeBron. You think LeBron's good.
Oh, LeBron is the best. You know, like you said the other day, you either take power or you take finesse. You know, I take finesse with Kobe because Kobe has the in-between game. LeBron doesn't have that yet. Once he gets that in-between game where he can pull up 8 feet from the basket and hit the little run on the jumper and stop trying to dunk everything or lay everything up, he's going to be the best ever.
When you played with Kobe Bryant, what's he like at practice?
I tell people all this, he's the hardest worker ever in practice. He gets there before everybody else. This is the best player in the world now. He gets there before everybody gets there. He works hard. We're leaving. He's still there practicing. I mean, if you tell him he cannot do something, he's going to challenge you. He says, I'm going to go in the gym and I'm going to practice on it. And I guarantee you in 4 days, he can add it to his repertoire.
Isn't that amazing?
It's really amazing. It's freakish.
So it's funny. You played in the NBA for a long time. You told me during the break you missed the bus rides and you miss. Were there cities that, like, sometimes – you can say it now. were there certain NBA cities you didn't like to go to? They're boring.
I hated going to Denver because it was always cold. And I hated going to Detroit because it was always cold. Loved going to Miami because it was always hot and you had some good places to eat. And I love going to the South. I'm from Alabama, and I love the South. I love going to the ATL because I got to see my mom, my father come to the game. So that's the best thing.
You know, when you, it's just you've been on, you know, you people like you. I mean, you were Big Shot Bob. And it's funny because a lot of great players aren't clutch. As great as Peyton Manning is, you could make an argument he's not clutch. Where do you develop that? Family? You loved the Big Shot.
Yeah, I do. I remember I've only gotten upset one time. We was playing New York in a game, and Pop took me out of the game, and they actually caught me on film taking my shirt off, going all mad and stuff. But for me, it's just it's what little kids do every day in the playground, 5-4-3-2-1. You always want to be the star, because a lot of times you can't be the star all the time, say like a Kobe or Dwayne Wade. You have to take a backseat to those guys because those guys are – going to dominate the ball. But down the end of the stretch, you know those guys going to have faith in you to believe in you. You know, like at Paxson, you know, all these guys who've come out that, you know, Michael Jordan made those guys famous. You just got to have the ability to knock down these shots and have the confidence in yourself and have the players to have the confidence in you that you're going to do it. So you had to no fear, basically, no fear.
Was every team you were on, you never played on a team that failed to make the playoffs, and you were never eliminated in the first round, so you were mostly on good teams.
Exactly.
But
because of me.
That's right, because of But there are great locker rooms, there are good locker rooms, and sometimes locker rooms go south.
Yeah.
Were you ever in a bad locker room that it just didn't feel good?
I know you're trying to sneak around and ask me the question about Shaq and Kobe, but this is the God honest truth. Guys, we would come to practice, and people were like, so Shaq said this about Kobe, Kobe said this about Shaq. They never had any problems in the locker room. We were always laughing and joking with each other in the locker room, talking about what we're going to do, talking about our kids, our family, what our kids have done. So I've never been in a locker room there was any problems. I've been blessed to be on some very veteran teams, and everybody loved one another because the ultimate goal was to go out and win championships regardless of if I didn't like you or you didn't like me.
Now, you had Greg Popovich. You had Phil Jackson, two of the greatest coaches ever. What's the difference between Greg Popovich and Phil Jackson?
They both emphasize defense, and Pop emphasizes a lot more than Phil. And Phil emphasizes offense a lot more than Pop. But the thing that makes Phil so good is the offense and the coaching staff they have. People always talk about the head coach. You have to look at what's behind you. That coaching staff he has is phenomenal. I'm not saying what Pop has, not fun, but they all understand that triangle offense, and they realize that basketball players need to touch the basketball. You know, you have a lot of offense out there where you might not go down the floor about three or four trips and not touch the basketball. But in triangle offense, you have some plays where everybody has to touch the basketball, so you feel involved in the game.
Sure.
So that makes the offense run smoothly and makes you not go into la-la land.
Most underrated player in the NBA.
Right.
When you played, a guy that players thought was really good and didn't get the media or fan love.
Outside of me?
Outside of you, never did.
I don't think nowadays it's nobody like that. Because every time you turn on the TV, you got games on this channel, games on that channel. You know, ESPN is covering the games, you know, 24/7. So there's nobody out there. I take that back. I'm sorry. Joe Johnson.
Atlanta.
Because he's in that market where nobody goes to watch him play. And I was so happy when Phoenix let him go the year that he was with Phoenix and they had that great championship running team. I was like, oh, man, thank you. He's the best player in the West outside of Kobe. He doesn't get enough praise for how good he is.
All right, back in a second with Robert Horry. We'll keep you to the top of the hour. Robert Horry, 7-time NBA champ. It's The Herd on ESPN Radio.
The Herd with Colin Cowherd.
Now, live from ESPN The Weekend, here's Colin Cowherd.
Well, the greatest NBA game I've ever been to was Lakers-Portland Trailblazers, Game 7.
Yeah.
And the Lakers were down almost by double digits at one point. Almost 20. Made a furious comeback in Game 7. Nothing would fall for the Blazers. Kobe alley-oops to Shaq. It's that sort of iconic picture. You started that rally with a steal and a three and got the Lakers. Was that one of the greatest games you've ever played in?
That was one of the greatest games. If you go back and look at it, so much drama. You're in your building. You got Scottie Pippen on the Portland team who knows the triangle offense like the back of his hand. He's telling everybody what to go on. It's like when the Raiders played the Bucks in the Super Bowl. It was like, oh, you're going to do this now. And it was hard to get your offense accomplished when the other team knows exactly what you're doing.
Yeah. And, okay, you played with Shaq and Hakeem and Tim Duncan. Who's the best?
Hakeem, he's better because, number one, he can shoot free throws. He plays D. He's not afraid of, you know, he's all-time shot blocker. So the things Dream used to do, just go back and look at what he did to David Robinson in that playoff series, how he brought moves out that we were actually on the court going, ooh, wow. You know, you never did that.
Right.
But Dream was just phenomenal.
Well, plus, he ate up Shaq early in his career. When Hakeem and Shaq met early, even Shaq came out and said, that guy's the guy.
Yeah, you got it. But then, it would be interesting to catch a young Dream against the 2000 Shaq when Shaq won MVP. So it'd be very interesting because Shaq had everything going for him then.
Now, how much did you weigh when you played?
I went, when I first got in the lead, I weighed 215. I weighed 265 now. So my plan weight was 245.
About 245.
Right.
Is it hard to keep weight on with all the cardiovascular stuff in a season?
I would start a season out at 255, and by the end of the season, I'd be 255. Face would be all skinny, and it's hard to keep weight. You try everything. You're drinking milkshakes at night. You even drink, I hate to say this, but you drink beer. You try to keep the calories in you as much as possible. But with all the running and the bad eating, because we eating at 1 o'clock in the morning because we just finished a game, so it was hard to keep on weight.
Well, it's great seeing you. A 7-time NBA champ, 16 years in the league, made the playoffs every year, never eliminated in the first round, still holds the record for most playoff games.
Right, most playoff games, most threes in the NBA final.
Wow.
Most steals.
Let's hear it for Robert Horry.
Thank you so much.